So today let's have a fire extinguisher because it's bloody hot here and let's try to fix a vintage electric clock. This is an old electric clock. It says Ruhla Electric, made in Germany, probably East Germany. And it's an electric clock, not electronic or quartz or crystal controlled. I think there were three evolution stages of battery-powered clocks. Of course, before the battery-powered clocks, you had to basically wind your clock manually, and the clocks were powered using a spring. And an electric clock, the first generation of battery-powered clocks, does not actually differ from this too much, because it still works like a mechanical clock, other than it uses a battery and an electromagnet or a DC brushed motor to periodically wind its spring. And there are no active components, no transistors or anything. Then the second evolution stage would be a so-called electronic clock. As an example, I have this Soviet Mayak clock, and this mechanism actually uses a single transistor, but still no crystal and no chip. And here the balance wheel has a magnet on it, and the energy is actually added into the system through the balance wheel. It has a magnet on it, and there is a coil in a circuit that basically otherwise works as a Joule thief, a center-tapped coil. One winding is driven by the transistor and the other one is the feedback for the base. This is some sort of an electromechanical oscillator, not a crystal oscillator yet. And the third, the last evolution stage of battery-powered clocks would be the crystal-controlled clock. And this is how analog clocks are made to this day, but here is an older example of it, probably from the 70s or 80s. And you can see the big crystal here. There is a through-hole chip in it, an 8-pin chip. An adjustable capacitor to adjust the speed of the crystal. You don't really see this nowadays. Some old electrolytic capacitor and a big coil as a part of this synchronous motor. But I will take a closer look at electronic and crystal controlled clocks in some other videos. And of course normal mortals call crystal controlled clocks quartz clocks. But now let's go back to our electric clock. This German clock is not working, so let's try to fix it today. Here you can see the mechanism. Here's the space for a D-size battery, which goes in like this. It says made in Germany and it says Richtige Polung beachten, which means observe the polarity, which is a bit strange because I thought this has just the battery, the contacts and the coil, which would not be polarity sensitive. And this thing can be removed from here after removing this. And here's the mechanism. It's similar to a mechanical clock that you wind by hand, but it has this coil, this electromagnet, which periodically winds it for you. And then it runs. And here I can see the reason why you have to Richtige Polung beachten. Besides the battery, the coil and the contact, there is also a diode on the coil, which of course would not be in pre-solid state era clocks. This diode is parallel to the coil and it's not necessary, but it basically clamps the inductive spikes from the coil when the contacts turn off and it reduces their arcing and so it prolongs their life. And the contact is on this part of the electromagnet, the moving part of it, and it also uses the contact to push it like this. The contact is basically also what transfers the force from the electromagnet to this spring powering the clock. And of course here you can see the balance wheel with a hairspring, just like in a mechanical clock. Here is the escape wheel. There is several more gears in a row, gearing it to a faster speed, going from this flywheel and this spring, and somewhere to this chain of gears the hands are connected. And of course the reason for the flywheel on the spring is that this electromagnet actually accelerates the flywheel and it actually keeps moving a bit past this point. The flywheel makes it travel a bit past the point where the electromagnet completely closes, and this is necessary because this separates the contacts. This removes the current from the coil and allows it to go back. And the coil says 1.8 ohms, 420 turns, 0.42 millimeters diameter copper lacquered wire, UMF Ruhla. But for some reason the self-winding mechanism doesn't seem to work. Let's give it a battery and it does not pull. If I help it a little bit, Now it clicked. Let's try to check the coil. And it's 1.8 ohms, as it should be. And the entire circuitry of the clock is just this. Just the battery, the contact, and the coil with an anti-parallel diode. And there is really not much to go wrong. And of course it's impossible to check the diode in parallel to the coil, but if the diode was open circuit, it doesn't really change much. And if it was short circuit, I would measure less resistance on the coil and in the clock. The entire mechanism here is connected to the positive of the battery, and the core of the electromagnet is connected to the coil and through the coil to the negative. And of course the core of the electromagnet has to be isolated from this metal system using this plastic spacer. And of course if the principle isn't still obvious to you, let's show this artificial intelligence generated augmented reality special effect computer simulation. Here is the battery, here is the spring powering the clock, and with the flywheel and the contact on it. The other contact is on the electromagnet, and the clock is basically running and the spring is slowly unwinding until it hits this contact. Now the coil of the electromagnet is powered and it pulls and it pushes this flywheel and winds the spring until the electromagnet fully closes. But now because the flywheel has accelerated, it continues past this point a bit and it breaks the contact. And so the electromagnet goes back and it opens like this. And it all repeats. It runs in cycles. And one cycle can be, let's say, 1 minute or half a minute or something like this. And when the electromagnet engages, it's just a fraction of a second. So it doesn't draw that much from the battery, because it runs on the spring for a minute and then in a fraction of a second it winds back. Most of the time it doesn't draw anything from the battery. But of course now the question is, what's wrong with the clock? Why it doesn't wind? Now it's actually stuck in the position where the contact is hit, but the electromagnet doesn't pull. Let's check the contacts. It's low resistance. It's now making contact and the resistance of the contact is much lower than the resistance of the coil. So it should pull and start running, but it doesn't. Let's try to measure if it draws any current from the battery. And it draws 0.65 amps. So it powers the coil, but the coil doesn't pull. Is the battery too weak? Let's measure it. It's 1.5 volts, and when I insert it, does it pull the voltage of the battery down too much? Let's measure on the battery. It pulls it down to 1.3 volts. It seems most of the voltage remains on the battery. But anyway, let's also try this 2AA to D cell adapter. You basically put 2AA cells in it and it turns them into a D cell shape. This is very cheap from eBay, of course. And let's try to put it in and still nothing. There is still about 1.3 volts going into the clock. Of course it draws a lot of current. And of course in the history of the clock some batteries leaked into it and it stained here and you can see the marks from it here. Leaking batteries are horrible. And this is one of the reasons for this adapter. Not only it allows you to use more common AA's than these obsolete D cells, but also having the batteries in this thing makes it less likely to leak into the clock. You still have some chance that the leaking liquid will stay in this adapter. For some reason the electromagnet can't develop enough force to wind it. Now the batteries are in. If I help it a little bit, it clicks now. But why does it not click by itself? When I bypass the contacts, it actually moves, but now it's not loaded by the spring. You don't think an electromagnet can get weaker by itself? It's getting enough voltage from the batteries. Just slightly under the nominal voltage of the batteries, but of course a high current will always load the voltage down a bit. One possible explanation why it's so weak might be because it opens too wide. Maybe this mechanism, this red thing which stops it, actually allows it to open too wide, and this makes it weaker. Because basically the closer this metal is to the other metal, the stronger is the magnetic force. And the wider it opens, the less initial force. Another possible explanation is that this mechanism is for some reason harder to turn than it used to be. He tries to lubricate it, but it doesn't help. It might be seizing up, or did somebody try to tighten the spring for some reason? And there is also a ratcheting mechanism. Maybe this one is harder to move than before. And the necessary force basically depends on the spring force, plus this ratcheting mechanism force, plus the friction in this system. Of course, I can try to connect a lithium-ion battery to it, and it works, because there is about 2.5 times the voltage on it. But not sure this is the right way of fixing it. Of course, the electromagnet has a return spring, which I didn't draw in the picture, but this one is quite weak. It doesn't really load the electromagnet too much. Now it actually stopped. It doesn't pull enough with 1.5 volts. One possible solution would be to make this spring less tight, but this would probably make the clock run slower or keep stopping. Loosening the spring would be actually the right solution only if somebody in the past tightened it in a desperate attempt to solve some problem, like the clock running too slow or stopping, but such problem probably should have been fixed a different way. I'm thinking maybe this is bent and it allows it to open too much. This end stop might be bent because when the battery runs out, the mechanism forces this electromagnet wider open. And this piece of brass actually looks bent. Not sure, was it meant to be bent like this or was it meant to be straight? And did somebody actually tighten the spring trying to fix it? If it's the case, I probably can't mess it up even more. There is nothing worse than trying to fix something somebody previously tried to fix the wrong way. And you can see there is one screw, which is completely different and too long and too big. Somebody apparently already opened it and lost one screw and put some completely different screw instead of it. And now it seems to be sort of working. I slightly reduced the gap in the electromagnet, which seems to make it work. I also tried to untighten the spring, which also seems to have helped quite a lot. There is this small nut which you untighten and then you can turn this ring, tightening or untightening the spring. And I also messed up a little bit here because I marked the original position of it, but I untightened it too much and it completely unwinded it, so now I don't know if it was here or here but one revolution tighter. I slightly reduced the gap in the electromagnet, but it's still wider than the gap when I pushed it previously and it clicked. It now definitely operates with a wider gap, which probably means it's not in the original position, but like one revolution less tight. I tried to untighten it even more from this position all the way here, and this seems to be the absolute minimum, which still makes it run without stopping. Now it's tighter than the minimum, but I guess it's one revolution less tight than before. I don't know exactly, I just messed up when untightening. It just spun freely and I should have untightened it much more carefully. And another reason why I think it's one turn less tight now is that when the electromagnet engages, now the flywheel actually makes it wind much farther than before. The electromagnet pushes the contact about 4 millimeters and then it travels by its momentum about another 6 millimeters. Now this is my current position. This is the loosest position of the spring, which still makes it run, and this is the tightest position of the spring, where the electromagnet can still pull it with this wide of a gap. Now I am basically in the middle of the interval where it works, and coincidentally it's where the original mark is, but I really think it was one turn tighter before. I'm really thinking more and more, somebody just over-tightened it, trying to desperately solve some problem. Maybe some solidified grease in it. I cleaned it using a brake cleaner, which is a horrible solution probably, but anyway, it seems to work now. We of course have to observe the speed of it and adjust it using this, which basically moves the slot on the spring, on the hairspring, changing its effective length. The shorter the active length of the hairspring, the faster. And of course, if the optimum speed turns out to be outside of the range of this adjustment, I will have to move this, tighten or loosen the spring. Now both adjustments are set in the middle. I decided to take a look from the other side and I removed the 4 screws. Almost every one of them is different. And this comes out and here's the dial with some damage from the corrosion from the leaking battery. You can remove the hands from it, I guess. This comes off and here is this. Let's try to unscrew these 3 screws. And the mechanism separates from this board. And there is one screw for the battery connection here. There's really not much to see on this side other than this mechanism where you can set it, you push it, it engages and you turn it. And this minute hand and hour hand concentric shaft and one of the jewels of the balance wheel. And a couple more views from different angles. And of course the coolest part of it, the escapement. And of course the right way would be to take it completely to individual bits and clean everything and re-lubricate it using several different special clock oils. Each of them for different parts of the clock based on the forces and the speed of the things at that spot and the materials, and there's probably a reason I prefer digital clocks. Or you can just flush it with a brake cleaner from the outside and then re-lubricate it from the outside using some very thin oil. Of course using just a super tiny amount, and you can clean the excess using something like this because the viscosity can also make it stop. And of course watch repair guys are probably pulling their hair out, but in the old days to lubricate a pendulum clock people would pull a feather out of a goose and dip it in whatever slippery substance comes out of it when baking it and use it to lubricate their clocks. And the diode is apparently germanium. Trying to fix the peeling pain here using a gold pen, and I'm thinking, how many bloody warnings can you put on a bloody pen? If you put that many warnings on a pen, what you're supposed to put on a barrel of perchloric acid, for example? No individual can stop this crazy society from getting even crazier. It's like a speeding runaway train, nobody can stop. Everybody just struggles to survive in this nonsense, trying not to get sued for somebody else's stupidity. But anyway, let's put it back together. Now it's back together, it's running. Now I just have to adjust it, but of course this mechanical thing is never going to be as accurate as a crystal controlled clock. The error is always going to be at least an order of magnitude higher. The accuracy of these mechanical contraptions can't be measured by modern standards. So that's it, it's fixed or restored. To the extent a sane person can go restoring a dumpster clock or a $10 clock. And there seems to be a date code, 28/12/1968 or 66 or something. So that's it, and if you like my videos, please consider supporting my channel on Patreon, using the thanks button or subscribing. And big thanks to all of you who already support me. And what do you think? Should I stick to electronics or should I try to fix more clocks?